the theme, the direction we're going here, I'm absolutely convinced is spot on.
So there's a number of things here that I want to, you know, address and talk with you about. One thing we can just, I guess, what your theory is or what you feel when it comes to this, because the Earth is estimated, you know, to be around 4.6 or so billion years, and then some of the moon rocks brought back, you know, by Apollo were dated around 5.3 billion years old. So what do you think has happened here? One theory I've heard is that the moon might have actually been sort of towed into place. Another theory is that it might have been built on the spot, like the Death Star or something like that. Where do you stand on that, Paige?
Well, my jury's out on that. My inclination is it's a hollowed-out planetoid. We've got to kind of, leave that on the boiling pot, because we got to first understand where the level of capability is that we're actually dealing with. You know, I mean, what are these people capable of? I mean, to holler out a bloody planetoid, and I mean, that's fantastic enough.
Sure.
Construct it from scratch, it's even more fantastic. But I tell you what, it's interesting on that hollowing out, you know, because the Soviet scientists who wrote that article saying they believed it was a hollow. They talked about it being a hollowed-out planetoid, and they explain. I quote them in great detail in the book, but they talk about the fact that they say it was hollowed out, and it's interesting. People like a guy called Dr. D.L. Anderson, professor of geophysics and director of the seismological laboratory at California Institute of Technology, actually said, because the way the moon's put together, the moon is made inside out, and interestingly. I then called my great friend in South Africa, Crater Mutwa, the nearly 90-year-old now Zulu shaman, who was initiated into this hidden knowledge like 50, 60 years ago. And I didn't say anything to him. I'd come by this point to the conclusion that what I'm saying is the way we're going with this. But I never told him any of this. I just called him. And I said, can you tell me any Zulu or African legends about the moon? And he said, yes, we say the moon is an egg. Now, of course, your anthropologists turn up from mainstream science. They go, they're primitive people who think the moon's an egg. Well, actually, that's a bit more than that. The reason they say it's an egg, interestingly, is they say it's been hollowed out. And then he told me... one of the Zulu legends about the moon. And he said that the legends say that the moon was brought here hundreds of generations ago by two brothers, Wawani and Umpanku, who were leaders of the Chitahuri. Now, the Chitahuri is the Zulu name for the reptilians, mm-hmm. the children of the serpent. And he said that the two brothers, Wawani and Mpanku, were known as the Water Brothers and had scaly skin like a fish. The legends say that Wawani and Mpanku stole the moon in the form of an egg from the great fire dragon and emptied out the yolk until it was hollow. They then rolled the moon across the sky to the earth and caused great cataclysmic events on the earth when it arrived. And so... you look at that, and I'm sitting here. I'm thinking, whoa! You know, when you're looking at, I find it very compelling, Henrik. When you look at these ancient legends and these myths, and then you look at the science that we know anyway, and they start to sink. Mm-hmm. And there are so many anomalies with regarding the moon. It's too big, too far out to be a natural satellite of the Earth, so they tell us. Why the moon has very shallow craters, and it seems that the depth of the crater does not kind of sync with the size of the impact.
Mm-hmm.
And what these scientists were saying, Soviet scientists, they said the moon had to be constructed to survive going through all the impacts and all the battering that it would obviously get. And he said that they reckon that there's an outer protection covering of about 2.5 miles, something like that, 2.5, 3 miles, something like that, they said in 1970, which is to absorb the initial impact. And then from that 2 miles, 3 miles, whatever it is, outer protection, there is then, they said, a 20-mile, in their estimation, solid impregnable barrier. And the indication was that when the moon's hit by something, it impacts upon the immediate outer protection,
which is soft, then, so it kind of muffles the blow a bit, right?
Yeah, and then it can't get beyond this 20-mile impregnable shield. Mm-hmm. And then inside that, there you have definitely on the surface and at other levels too, you have what's actually going on there, and the technology that's actually shooting out these various frequencies to block information and to give us information which we decode when it's a fake reality, a moon matrix. And it's something that we're going to have to look at, because the evidence is going to continue to come out that's going to make us look at this. I mean, when I was writing the book, Henrik, I turned on the television to see that NASA was bombing the moon. What's all that about? Mm. Oh, we want to see if it got water. How much did that cost to bomb the moon and see if it's got water? Mm. And then last August, I was with Craig Mutler, funny enough, in South Africa, and there was a news story, where a mainstream news story, where NASA said the moon is shrinking. They found these ridges all over it, which they say indicates that the surface is coming together. It's shrinking and causing the land to rise up in these ridges. There's so many things about the moon we don't know about, and I'm sure that we're going to have to really look at this seriously, at how we're being manipulated via the moon. In fact, you know, have you ever seen that I'm sure you have, that American film called They Live?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Well, you see, for people that haven't, it's a story that came in the 1980s, but it was set about now, funny enough, a bit in the future. And to cut a long story short, this guy came across some sunglasses that were specially designed so that when he put them on, he didn't see the world he saw without them. When he put them on and he looked at a news magazine, instead of seeing text and pictures, he just saw subliminal messages: stay asleep, obey authority. He looks around at the advertisements in the street that are saying, you know, vacation in Jamaica or buy Coke or whatever, and he didn't see the adverts with the glasses on. He saw subliminal messages saying stay asleep, do as you're told, and all that stuff. And then when he goes through an area where there's people, he sees that some people, most people, are still human when he puts the glasses on, but some of them ain't, that look human when he hasn't got them on. Some of them are clearly not human. And the story goes on as he starts to understand what's happening, that the world has been taken over by these non-humans hiding behind human form, which is I've been writing about all these years. And they work out that actually the reason humans can't see them, and he can only see them with the glasses, is because, and it's all symbolic, I would suggest, there's a dish transmitting a frequency from the top of a television tower that is blocking the people's ability to see what these people really are. Mm. And what they do then is that they you know, the story in the film, they stop the dish broadcasting, and suddenly people are sitting in bars, walking down the street, whatever, and suddenly the person next to them's not human anymore. They can see them, because this frequency has been switched off. And that, Henrik, for me, really, really is a fantastically symbolic explanation of what is actually happening. Mm-hmm. And the thing is this, this is another key reason, mate, why they have to keep us in a low vibrational mental and emotional state of consciousness. Because what they're broadcasting has a frequency, yes, but it has a frequency range. And if you open your mind and access levels of consciousness that are beyond that frequency, that, and this is what's happening with this awakening, its impact upon you is diluted and diluted until you go beyond it, and then not only is it not impacting on you like it was in terms of your sense of reality, you actually are aware, conscious enough to see that it's happening and what's going on.
Yeah.
And we're going to have some amazing kind of revelations coming along in the next few years that are going to just reveal how deep this rabbit hole goes. Now, it's right, and I do it, it's right that we expose the five sense level of this conspiracy. Absolutely, I'm doing it all the time, as much as I can, the banking scams and the political scams and the engineered wars, etc. But if we hold it there, we leave it there, then we're only getting a fraction of what there is to know, because that's just, if you like, that's like the movie screen being played out, where we can see it, but it's being projected from somewhere else. And the moon, yes, Saturn, I'm absolutely convinced that is the very well be that the moon is a satellite, a transmitter, if you like, magnetic system for Saturn. I wouldn't rule that out. I'm not saying it is. I wouldn't rule it out. Mm. And it's interesting, isn't it, mate? Who's got all these moons?
Yeah, Saturn. Exactly. Saturn. Yeah.
More than 60, isn't it? Mm. I was reading today, and I mean, so, you know, these are little bits of information, but they're eventually going to be added to so that we can actually link these dots in an even more profound way. And where does it go from there? You know, when you're dealing with all possibility, where does it end? But we've come a long way in the areas that we're talking here about, Henrik. We've come a long way from it's a few people sitting around a table wanting to take over the world because they're just greedy. Those people do exist on the level that they operate at, but that's not where it's coming from.
Obviously, before we wrap things up here for the first hour, David, let's just briefly talk about your appearances up here in the Nordic countries. You're coming up to Copenhagen, you're coming up to Stockholm May 8th. Our friend Peter Pettersson from anarchos.se is putting this one together as well. I was at the conference last year in Gothenburg, also put together by him, really good one. And for people who want to have tickets, obviously, and more information about your lecture in Stockholm on May 8th, again, just go to anarchos.se. I will have this linked up on the website as well. But then you're coming to Copenhagen. Is that before or after Stockholm, David?
Yeah, if people go to my website as well, they'll get all the places I am, because I'm in a lot of places this year. First of all, I'm leaving in a couple of days. We've got to speak in Germany, in Bavaria. Hey Bavaria.
How about that? We were there recently, actually. It's a lovely place. You're not going to Ingolstadt, are you?